Everyone's excited, happy. I like the chatter. It's good. It's good. I tried to make all the people in the back move up, but some of them just refused to. Reva and yeah, I see you guys back there. Fred moved up like five rows, so I appreciate that. This is a pretty great sized crowd that we got here in a pretty awesome room. I think this is the first time we've been in this room. I missed like four readings, so I don't really know what's happened all week. But it's nice to be back with you guys for our very last installment of this January's Lectores reading series. Let's give that a round of applause. And we're gonna finish off with a bang. We've got Mikhail Iossel and Jeff Parker, and it's not a residency without an introduction by this man. So, ladies and gentlemen, Stefan Kiesbye.
Everybody can hear me? Micro's okay? Cool, thank you. Growing up, because I grew up in Germany, I heard a lot about poets and thinkers. They were not different people, but if you were a poet, you had to be a thinker also. And a thinker surely was a poet as well, if her thoughts were true enough. I never thought that it could be any different. Poets and thinkers were drawn to each other, will love to hate one another, thereby producing more thought and more poetry. Remember poet, playwright, and nonfiction author Václav Havel, who became the last president of Czechoslovakia and the first president of the Czech Republic. What hope and daring to elect a man of letters to the highest office. Writers in America are rarely seen and seldom heard, and often only when advertising a new book. There are few exceptions. We leave the heavy political lifting to actors, sometimes musicians, sometimes YouTube sensations. This is a strange arrangement. And not because other artists have nothing to say, but writers think on the page about what it means to be alive in a certain time, in a certain country, in a certain body, and a certain identity. Mikhail Iossel, the Leningrad-born author of the story collection Every Hunter Wants to Know, and co-editor of the anthologies America, Russian Writers View the United States, and Rasskazy, New Fiction from a New Russia, is a poet and thinker. Even though his preferred medium is prose, fiction, and nonfiction alike. Before the internet, there were days spent in the cafe known as Saigon, and I quote, at the corner of afternoons in there, at the corner of Nevsky and Vladimirsky prospects, where Leningrad Bohemians spent countless of afternoons in there and outside of it too, mainly outside of it, smoking, talking to people, watching the slow, slanted snowfall, looking at the ceaseless river of humanity flowing along the Nevsky and waiting for something, always waiting for something, until at some point taking off with a group of friends to buy several bottles of acrid Bulgarian red in a wine store across the way, and then to find some secluded, echoingly dark, dank entryway to drink it up there while sitting on second floor landing's wide window ledges to keep on drinking and talking there. This talk, this time for exchanging ideas, Mikhail has carried forward. And he's not shy to share his insight and his opinions on political events. In his essays and articles and posts, he examines what it means to be alive right now, right here. But he's not shouting. He's not engaging in the death matches we're used to seeing in the press and on TV. His articles are an invitation to join a discourse. He doesn't mince words, and yet he doesn't want to defeat or crush. He wants to keep the conversation alive. He creates community where others create tribes. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mikhail Iossel.
Hello.
Hello.
Thank you, Stefan. It's very, very kind and very flattering. And actually, collection of my Facebook posts, pieces, is coming out as a separate book at the end of the year. So it's kind of interesting development in and of itself. But what I want to read today, part of it, is an article which is part nonfiction and part fiction, which is not, again, characteristic of Foreign Policy magazine where it was published. But I told them that I can't write strictly nonfiction. And it's about Santa Barbara, so the soap opera. Does anybody remember? Does anybody know? Anybody remember? Yeah. Well, okay. Santa Barbara Forever, Santa Barbara Forever was stenciled boldly in tall purple chalk lettering on the side of my parents' apartment building in the southwestern part of St. Petersburg, Russia, when I returned to the renamed city of my childhood and youth, Leningrad, USSR, in 1993. It was the first time I'd been back since immigrating to the United States 7 years earlier. There were other signs of Santa Barbara's presence in the city, improvised tribute to the American soap opera in the historic downtown area, a hall in the wall cafe called Santa Barbara here, a Santa Barbara strip joint there. On several occasions, I was asked, typically by women, whether I had been to Santa Barbara myself, and if so, what it was like. I hadn't, unfortunately. Oh, you should go. That'd be the first place I would go if I could ever make it to America, a middle-aged sales clerk at the grocery store said to me with mild reproach. Santa Barbara certainly sounded nice. In Santa Barbara, people had manners. They had their self-respect about them. The men didn't urinate in hallways or write obscene words on the walls of elevator cabins there. They didn't smash light bulbs in entryway or drink cheap eau de cologne first thing in the morning. They didn't occupy the only toilet in the communal apartment for a good half hour or keep their dirty combat boots and homemade barrels of pickled mushrooms in the communal bathroom. And they certainly did not, out of pure malice, slip slivers of tar soap in other people's pans of soup boiling in the communal kitchen stove. Nor did they come home dead drunk past midnight and plop down on the couch face first with their shoes on and immediately start snoring. In Santa Barbara, men were men, real men, handsome and gallant, even if they were not necessarily very good people in all other respects. They didn't go through their entire lives without saying, "I love you," once to their women, especially to their wives, on whom admittedly they cheated mercilessly nonstop, but oh well, men would be men, wouldn't they? In Santa Barbara, men didn't die of cirrhosis of the liver barely past their mid-50s, and then did not appear to be million, and there did not appear to be millions more women than men there in Santa Barbara and in America on the whole. Early 1990s in Russia. It is a tough slog out there. The world has gone topsy-turvy completely. The eternally indestructible, matchlessly mighty Soviet Union is no more. It's Russia once again, unimaginably enough, for the first time in more than 7 decades, and to say that it is falling apart would be the understatement of the century. If you're an ordinary citizen whose time on Earth is closer to its end than to its beginning, strong chances are your lifetime savings have been wiped out completely overnight as a result of the so-called shock therapy implemented by Boris Yeltsin's government on the advice of several renowned American economists and the stealthy, lightning quick monetary reform was one of its main components. You are, to put it bluntly, destitute, and you are thoroughly disoriented. What happened here? What happened with you and your country? What's going to happen tomorrow? The food store shelves are emptier now than they have ever been before. even at the lower points of Leonid Brezhnev's stagnation. Goodbye, America, or Where I've Never Been, Vyacheslav Butusov, the charismatic leader singer of the popular rock band Nautilus Pompilius, croons periodically on the radio. America, my food. What's it really like? No one has much of an idea. Hopefully, those brilliant, internationally renowned American economists will show us right here in Russia what life in America is like, because everyone knows that life in America is unimaginably good. It's drafty and cold in your room, central heating defunct again. Outside in the streets and squares of your city, glum-looking people with dangerous glint to their slitted eyes are sitting on their haunches around makeshift bonfires in the dark. You feel as if you are suspended in mid-air above a roiling ocean of dark entropy. Do you know the word entropy? Well, that's not the point. There are precious few certainties in your life anymore. Santa Barbara is one of them, and it is the prettiest and most optimistic of all. Santa Barbara was the first American soap opera to be broadcast on Russian television. It started airing on January 2, 1992, with episode 217, and came to a close on April 17, 2002, with episode 2040. For the first several years, the new episodes ran 3 evenings per week. Later on, the show's broadcasts became fewer and further between. For 10 long years, all through the crime-ridden, chaotic 90s, the early post-Soviet years of timelessness and hardship, life in large cities, small towns, industrial settlements, and snowbound villages across Russia's 11 time zones would come to a standstill as the remarkably cheery sounds of Santa Barbara intro issued from millions of TV sets. Run on home, you don't want to miss Santa Barbara, the kindly pharmacist from a TV commercial would say to the old woman at the counter. It was that big a deal. Missing an episode was considered to be a personal mini tragedy. Santa Barbara's imprint was everywhere. It entered the Russian vernacular as a denotation for any hopelessly tortuous, excessively dramatic kind of relationship. Oh, I can't stand those two with their endless Santa Barbara. A well-known pop band, Mona Lisa, released a superhit, Santa Barbara, in which young women proclaimed their undying love for the character Mason Capwell, played by Lane Davis. Countless Russian dogs and cats bore the exotic names Mason, Eden, Cruz, and C.C. Capwell. A trickle of former Santa Barbara stars, Jed Allen, Lane Davis, Nicholas Koster, and others visited Russia at different times in the 1990s and 2000s, appearing on numerous TV channels, giving a plethora of print interviews gushing about the beauty of Russia and its men and women, and generally, one would imagine, feeling like the Beatles during their first tour of the United States. It was a national obsession of borderline insane magnitude. In Santa Barbara, it never snows. No one ever thinks about snow there, ever. It never gets to be minus 30 degrees in Santa Barbara, regardless of whether the temperature is measured in Celsius or Fahrenheit. Santa Barbarians know no privation. For instance, they have no idea what it feels like when the heat radiator in your room goes ice cold in the middle of January. In Santa Barbara, people don't ever go hungry either. The black-clad babushkas bent at the waist like dwarf trees on the Arctic Ocean shore don't go to newly restocked and expanded post-shock through capitalist food stores just to feast their purblind eyes on all those unimaginable food products they couldn't in their wildest dreams afford on their miserable pensions. Foreign cheeses and sausage, fresh meat, smoked fish. In Santa Barbara, old babushkas are not bent at the waist. They're not even babushkas at all. And they certainly don't live from month to month feeding themselves on nothing but black bread, rough gray military caliber macaroni, and potatoes, and perhaps a few hard lumps of sugar to suck on while drinking their weak Krasnodar tea from chipped faience cups. When old people in Santa Barbara get sick, they're not told by bored-looking paramedics that they have already lived quite long enough for an ordinary human being, so there really would be no moral rationale for wasting the extremely limited hospital space on the likes of them. In Santa Barbara, people never once, even in passing, mention Russia. That makes sense. Why would they ever give Russia a second thought? Tens of millions of Russian people, however, think about Santa Barbara quite an awful lot. If you don't watch Santa Barbara, where do you get your fashion sense or crucial lifestyle tips? How would you know how to decorate your palatial mansion and generally what kind of life to wish for on the very remote outside chance you ever manage to get to America? It's true, not everyone is a fan of Santa Barbara. As some of the show's mostly male detractors like to grumble, no one ever sees a single book or even a single bookshelf in Santa Barbara's stately mansions or large non-communal apartments. In Russia, that would be inconceivable, and that might indeed, to some extent, denote a certain measure of Santa Barbarians' inner emptiness. Fair enough, but then again, everyone already knows that Americans are kind of a little empty inside. So what? Not everyone can be as innately super spiritual as the Russian people, you know. That's the one thing that Russians have other people elsewhere, have other people elsewhere in the world don't. Their extreme spirituality. Well, okay, fine. So they don't read books in Santa Barbara and probably don't even know the names of Tolstoy or Pushkin or Chekhov. So what? Who cares, really? If truth to be told, Dostoevsky and Lermontov never told you anything about places like Santa Barbara. And what good did having every Soviet child and grown up read these great geniuses ever do for your country? Compare your ordinary Russian life with the way the non-bookish people of Santa Barbara live. Thank God for Santa Barbara. At least it doesn't make you morbidly depressed. Instead, it makes your life a little easier, more bearable, and less depressing by filling your head with beautiful, if ipso facto impossible, dreams. Santa Barbara, in a full entity of its irreality, is your lifeline to the reality of your life in Russia, of the timeless void of the 1990s. You may never have been anywhere outside your small town, somewhere in central Russia or Siberia, or outside the streetless concrete block box micro districts surrounding the downtown of every large Russian city, but you still have a feeling you know the people of Santa Barbara better than your own friends and relatives. You have a clear sense that if perchance you ever were to find yourself in Santa Barbara, which could happen, sure, why not, if only in another lifetime, you would feel right at home. But since the stubborn fact of your life happens to be that at this particular juncture you are still on your Russian lifetime, the next best thing is to create your own Santa Barbara right where you are. Saturate the space around you with those little archways that pop up on the TV screen to usher the view into the imaginary realm of Santa Barbara in the serial's intro. Let every space in your life, be it your apartment or your dolorous micro districts, be a symbolic passageway to a desperate, impossible dream. And those antique columns supporting nothing but air in Santa Barbara, you want those too, be it on your windowsill or just outside your apartment building, towering amid piles of post-industrial rubbish. And let the primary colors of your life, instead of the fearsome Soviet crimson red, be Santa Barbara's purple and gold. Okay, I'll stop here. It goes on for another pretty much the same kind of amount of space. But you get the point. Russians were crazy about Santa Barbara. And then they fell out of love with it. Because that's what happens in life. People fall in love with Santa Barbara and then they fall out of love with it. And then somebody like Putin comes along and starts basically injecting venom of anti-Americanism in the national vein, and that's all it takes. So let me read you a couple of pieces that I write directly into Facebook status box as an exercise, at least 3 or 4 per week I try to. So just to give you an idea, the kind of short pieces that will be in that book. Like millions of other Soviet kids, boiling points. Like millions of other Soviet kids of my time, my friends and I used to boil condensed milk in a large pan of water on the gas stove. It was an extremely popular thing to do back then, even though, generally speaking, the resulting tan-colored viscose mess, sweeter than sweet and tasting vaguely like toffee, was no more, and as far as I personally was concerned, less delicious than the starting product. Needless to say, we were completely unaware. We were, in effect, preparing the popular Latin American dessert called dulce de leche, and it wouldn't have made the slightest difference to us if we knew that. It was, I suppose, primarily the very process of altering, through boiling, the physical nature, visual aspect, and essential consistency of the unseen contents of an unopened metallic container, which was fascinating to us. We did this after school. In the space of 3 or 4 hours we typically had before my parents came home from work, in the kitchen of my family's apartment on Cosmonauts Avenue, in one of the dozens of the new micro-district neighborhoods on Leningrad's rapidly expanding outskirts. But then, admittedly, those later historical geographic details are of no real significance here. It was not a quick operation. In order to have its contents cooked through properly, thoroughly enough to an obvious degree of their having become something else, the 400-gram metallic cylinder of the sguschonka needed to be spent between an hour and a half and 2 hours in boiling water. And the longer the cooking time, the darker the former condensed milk's eventual color and the more solid the consistency were going to be. And so after the first sizable bubbles started gurgling up to the surface, we would lower the fire to medium heat and decamp to the living room to play our rowdy horse games there or to listen to the endlessly re-redubbed tapes of the great singer-songwriter Vladimir Vysotsky's unofficial concert on my parents' seriously heavy Dnieper 14A magnetophone, because when you are a young teen, watching water boil for 2 hours in the kitchen is not something you are or should be capable of doing. From time to time, however, one or more of us would return to the kitchen to check on the can in the boiling water, because it was a well-known fact that if the former was not fully covered by the latter, it could, and very likely would, explode. Still, sometimes entirely at random and with no visible warning signs, the can would explode even when being completely submerged in boiling water too. And that, of course, was the darkly dangerous Russian roulette quality of the whole undertaking. And if I were to venture a dully cerebral guess, from the remove of all these intervening decades, the unspoken main reason for our engaging in it. The terrible booming sound of the can's detonation would shake the floor and rattle the window panes in the apartment, filling our fluttering hearts with horrified ardor. The kitchen, when we would enter it cautiously a few long seconds later, would present a predictably dolorous sight. The quivering stalagmites of pale brown goo hanging from the ceiling, angry live splatters of the same protoplasmic substance everywhere on the walls, diarrheic sprays of it across the windows, nothing for the parents to rejoice at upon their return from work. The can, a twisted gaping wound of its former self, would be lying empty on the floor, bereft of purpose, and the condensed milk it used to contain would be free of its constraints, finally out in the open. But the expense of having been transmogrified permanently into something different, substance, and hot as hell. Yes, those were the days. I'm going to resist now the easy temptation to throw the flimsy footbridge of a needlessly extended metaphor between that accidental distant recollection and the increasingly dangerous condition America is in today. A can of condensed milk and rapidly evaporating boiling water it may or may not be, but it sure could explode at any unpredictable moment. But you, of course, should feel free to draw your own parallels if you'd like. An old blind man in a long wintry line to the beer kiosk told me once, decades ago, in another lifetime, in a world no longer in existence, in a glorious and terrible city which has since been renamed, that when he was a young prisoner in an Eastern Siberian gulag camp, he wrote poems for an imaginary fiancée at night in pitch darkness on scraps of cement paper bags with an illicit stub of lead pencil by the light of his own eyes. I told him that was a nice metaphor, and he said in response a little huffily that it was pure non-metaphoric truth. Why do you think I've been blind for so many years now? He added in a wistful tone, turning to me, his desiccated face with empty eye sockets. I burnt them out then, still no regrets. Just imagine that blue light in the night. I told him, feeling a shiver of strange unease scamper down my spine, that I sure hoped his imaginary fiancée had subsequently appreciated those doubtless lovely poems of his. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Mikhail. Jeff Parker is a triple threat, a rare combination of literary talent, managerial moxie, and personal magnetism. Let's start with the literary talent. He's the author of a novel, Ovenman, from Tin House, a story collection, The Taste of Penny, from Dzanc Books, and a marvelous nonfiction volume, Where Bears Roam the Streets. With Mikhail Iossel, he's edited two collections by contemporary Russian writers, and with Annie Leontis, a book of essays by writers about their mentors, a book called A Manner of Being. With Elena Raya Bobalova and Maria Gusev, he's translated a Russian novel, Shanka, and with Pasha Mala, he collaborated on the Found Sports poetry collection, Erratic Fire, Erratic Passion, which is a great fun book. That's novelist, short story writer, essayist, translator, editor, found poetry collaborator, and as it pertains to this group, of course, a beloved mentor. Then there's the literary entrepreneur. He's the co-founder and director of the DISQUIET International Literary Program in Lisbon. And closer to home, he was the founding director of this MFA program. Without his hard work, commitment, organizational skill here in Tampa, we would not be in this room tonight. We all owe him thanks for that, and me especially. And then there's the charisma. That blue-eyed sine qua non to which so many are drawn. Fortunately, I needn't strive further to describe it because in a moment it will be everywhere in evidence. He's one of those on whom nothing is lost, an emissary of levity and acuity. And you want that in a triple threat. Our own Jeff Parker, welcome.
That was very kind and embarrassing. What Don didn't tell you is that the story of the prehistory of this program, like 10 years before I showed up here, was him and a couple other colleagues here, trying to get the support in the university to make this thing happen. So we all owe him a big thanks as well. I haven't been here for a little while. As some of you know, I've been helping produce and rear a small, irrational being. So I just want to take just a minute to say thanks for having me back. Erica Dawson, who was also on that team that, made this MFA happen in the prehistory. She could just be a regular faculty member here and teach her poetry classes and teach, the undergrads and teach in the MFA, but she accepts this post. And she's so bad, she can even direct this program from a sick bed. So huge thank you to Erica Dawson, from me, from everyone, but. And I want to give a shout out to my mentor group this time, my mentee group, rather. We had a lot of fun sitting over in Sykes, being blasphemous, talking about why storytelling is important and why the world would be a better place if men understood no one wants to see a dick pic. We figured a lot of things out. Ask any of them. So what I'm going to try and do, I'm going to try and read about 8 pages from this nonfiction book, and then I think I'm going to read a couple pages from this this thing that looks like the Gideon Bible that just came out. With regard to this book, I actually have to really thank Mikhail Iossel because it's because of him. He started this program called Summer Literary Seminars in St. Petersburg, Russia, not across the bridge. And I went there in 1999 and befriended him and fell in love with the place. And I started going back every year and working with him. And you know, taking on more and more responsibilities, he really shepherded me in this whole, you know, notion of literary mentorship and you know, literary entrepreneurship, if you want to call it that. I just think of it as community building, you know, among writers who are a special breed. But he really led the way, he led me there. And after I'd been going to Russia for about 15 years, I wrote this book, and it's kind of a mix of memoir and biography and travel writing. But mostly it's about this bartender who I met, my first trip there, a guy named Igor. He's not a writer at all, he's just a dude about my age living in St. Petersburg, and we kind of struck up this unlikely friendship. So I'll just, I'll start reading a section. The only thing I think you really need to know, I'm about 80 pages in, the only thing I think you really need to know is in a previous chapter I've told in a lot of detail the intricate process he went through to evade the draft, because he came of age in Russia in 2000, I think, or 1999, right around when I met him, and there was a really brutal and savage war going on in Chechnya. And so he and they estimate tens of thousands of others paid bribes or engaged in the system of corruption to get out of going there. But we start in 2008, in the summer of 2008 here. The mob in line at McDonald's near the Moskovskaya metro stop was 10 people deep at 7 a.m. I did this at least once during each of my annual trips to Russia, had an egg McMuffin in the early morning when I'd grown tired of porridge and buckwheat pancakes. More of those unanswerable questions occurred to me. How can this egg McMuffin taste exactly like the same as those I had as a child in North Florida? What would these fresh-faced young Russian people be doing with their lives if they weren't working for the well-advertised stable wages and regular raises of McDonald's? Why is McDonald's the most popular Western fast food chain here when the others, most notably KFC and Subway, serve draft beer? A girl in the patio booth next to me left half her flapjacks on the table in the styrofoam pancake container, making a little party for the pigeons and starlings. No one here busses his own tray, but I felt compelled to. What is this strange compulsion? Does it mean I'm hopelessly fucked? My cell phone rang. It was Igor. It's a good day, he said, and then paused. Yeah, I said, it's nice. It's a good day to kill somebody. Listen, bring 4 liters of water, okay? Okay, I said. Then I bussed my own tray and bought 4 liters of water. I met Igor and his friend Alexei, the one we call Big Al, in the subway at Chornaya Rechka, near where Pushkin took a shot to the spleen and died in a duel. Igor and Big Al approached, two hulking skinheads. Igor wore torn jeans and a wrinkled button-down plaid shirt, Big Al sweatpants and a polo. We took an endless series of streetcars and buses and marshrutkas, each bus smaller than the last, until we were beyond the outskirts of St. Petersburg, and the marshrutka led us out in front of a gas station on a lonely stretch of highway. We ran across the road to a gas station parking lot where a group of people had gathered. The organizer, Misha, not our Misha, of course, another hulking skinhead, wore camo pants, combat boots, and a black t-shirt with a picture of a skull and crossbones and the word paintball. He welcomed me with a firm handshake and told us to climb into a car, any car that had room, and follow him. We drove 20 minutes down narrow dirt roads until we emerged onto the grounds of an abandoned cement factory on the bank of an inlet to the Finnish Gulf, where a pool of brown water oozed toward a bridge and a highway in the distance. Antifreeze bottles bobbed on the surface. Hundreds of spent condoms and smashed bottles of beer littered the ground. There was a crumbling barn that Misha forbade us to enter, a conveyor with several lookout posts connected to a control tower and a rusted out 18-wheel trailer. Behind the barn stood two dilapidated cranes. Bursts of paintball paint spattered every conceivable surface, red, blue, green, and yellow. The trailer facade looked like a giant Jackson Pollock. Surprising bursts of wildflowers matched the paint. Rigid growths of sharp rebar sprouted from the earth and from giant wedges of concrete. "Seriously, man," Igor said to me, "this is crap. And we will play in this crap. This is the worst, most dangerous playground I've ever seen." An endless line of cars filed in behind us, and more men and several women got out. Igor fired the X7, his new paintball gun that I had brought him from Toronto. $1,000 paintball gun. He fired the X7 for the first time across the canal. He held down the trigger and the automatic rat-a-tat-tat attracted a crowd. All wanted to turn firing it. One group of men with whom we'd soon be at war were shirtless, their bodies canvases of scars and tattoos and fresh and not so fresh paintball welts. Some also had precision high-dollar semi-automatic markers, though not quite as swank as Igor's. Some groups seemed to be organized into teams. They communicated through wireless walkie-talkie headsets and lined up along the banks of the inlet, shooting at the antifreeze bottles bobbing in the brown water. To kill time before the games began, they took cell phone pictures of each other blindfolded on their knees with paintball guns held to their heads. I'd never played paintball before. I rented a marker from the organizer, Misha, that fired one paintball at a time. And whereas the others' guns torpedoed a barrage of paintballs across the expanse of the canal, mine lobbed a single paintball about 20 feet before it splooshed into the water. Igor told me that, with this rental marker, I fell into the category of what the experienced players call hamsters. We gathered in a circle as Misha explained the rules and scenarios. If you're hit, you immediately hold the marker in the air, which means you're dead. You return to base. I speak passable everyday Russian, but much of what he said was war and weapons specific, and afterward, Igor asked him to elaborate on a few things for me. The main thing, Misha said, is not to impale yourself on the rebar. He pointed to a sharp spike of metal sticking out of a hunk of cement. "Got it," I said. Misha and his wife handed out the red and yellow bandanas to differentiate the two teams. Igor and I drank water and some raspberry tea he'd brought in a thermos. I asked him where the vodka was, and he shook his head disapprovingly. "You can't drink while playing paintball," he said. "Alcohol makes your mask fog." It didn't seem to bother our opponents, the gang of Chechen vets. The first game was a usual scenario. Our team dispersed into the landscape. We had about 2 minutes, after which one of the referees in neon vests blew a whistle. The other team charged after us. Igor and I hid in the thick of the brush around the cement factory barn. The ground crunched under my feet. I crouched along behind Igor, using him as a shield. He climbed onto the roof of the dumpster and hunkered, mowing down some yellow team guys trying to stealth by on the other side. He leapt from the dumpster and rolled through a dusty pile of spent condoms. He came up firing and turned a 360 into the cover of a tree before hitting the deck flat. Because my hamster marker lobbed, I had to aim up if I wanted to get any distance and let the arc take it. Despite his move, someone pegged Igor on the side of his helmet with a splash of red paint. I climbed down the back of the dumpster and utilized Misha as my replacement human shield. We picked our way through thick bushes to the top of a small hill. I fired into the sky in hopes that my bullets might rain down on someone from the yellow team. Two members of the yellow team wearing slick blue helmets, the walkie-talkie guys, popped up in front of us. They pelted Misha, but I managed to duck back. Misha slapped at his chest, and his hand came away covered in orange paint. "Avenge my death, Jeff," he shouted. I avenged his death. And as I reveled in the pride of my first kill, a green paintball tagged me in the meat of the thigh. I asked our fellow combatants about their attraction to paintball. A few of them, like Igor, seemed to have somehow or other conned their way out of the military. Most of the guys we were fighting beside and against were former special forces and Chechen vets. Vadim, a veteran and neighbor of Igor's in Piskarovka, told me, paraphrasing, if I've got the origin of this correct, Jesse Ventura, "Once you've hunted men, it's not interesting to hunt animals anymore." Vadim was on the yellow team. I didn't know what exactly the attraction was for Igor. If I had narrowly avoided conscription in a cruel military and a brutal war, I'd feel for some reason honor-bound to not engage in elaborate pretend dramatizations of combat. I tried to get a bead on Igor's feeling about it, but he kept dodging. "Did you see my dismount from the dumpster?" he said, changing the subject. He smiled at the aesthetics of it, and I have to admit, at least as far as simulated combat goes, he looked pretty good doing it. Later, in the middle of the capture the flag scenario, Igor answered his cell phone, and it was his fiancée, Anya. She was nonplussed that he was spending the day playing paintball with us rather than hanging out with her. The conversation was a short one. He recounted it to me after. "I just wanted to tell you that I'm not pissed at you anymore," she said. "Baby," he said, "I'm busy right now. You know this. Fuck you," she said, and hung up. Word began to circulate that I was not only a hamster, but a foreign hamster. A foreign hamster on the paintball field. Suddenly, everyone on the yellow team was gunning for me. A whole commando unit, led every time it seemed by Vadim, hunted me down early in each scenario. Misha announced a modification of the scenario rules, which Igor translated as unlimited respawn. In unlimited respawn, returning to camp after your shot brings you back to life. But upon my resurrection, I was instantly killed again and again. Sometimes it was funny for a yellow team sniper to shoot me in the back or in the ass at the very moment of my respawn. Big Al stomped back to camp for a drink of water. "I like paintball," he said, "but I don't like how fast I die." He cut back onto the field again, and Igor whispered, "Al is huge, good target." We paused for lunch, potato and barley soup. Igor and I shared the rest of his thermos of hot raspberry tea. One wouldn't imagine Igor to be the type to bring a thermos of hot raspberry tea to paintball, but there it is. After lunch, we played everyone's favorite scenario, narco traffic. One team member with a blue beach ball is the narco dealer, and he has several points across the field to which he must deliver drugs. Our job was to cover him. No respawn on this one. I got shot in the side of the head, and I returned to base camp to inspect my welts and swab the paint out of my ear. The final scenario was called Massacre. Everyone against everyone. Teams be damned. Igor and I decided to sit out the massacre. We peeled off our fatigues by the trash receptacles made from real RGD2 grenade crates. I had perfectly circular red welts all over me. I noticed that Igor had two of the nicotine patches I'd brought him from Canada duct taped to his shoulder. A black German Shepherd puppy, Misha's paintball mascot, decided to sniff us out. It was named Russia. Not Russia, a light, noble word, almost a whistle, which means Russia in Russian, but the English word Russia, which trundles out of a Russian mouth with a long rumbling R, culminating in shh, like the dramatic shh of Shazam, before exhaling into the final ah. At that moment, Vadim passed by and fired his paintball marker into the dirt. Russia scrambled under the van into the soft sand and whimpered. Vadim smiled, showing his gray teeth. Parentheses, next time we saw this dog at another paintball game a year later, it was full grown and fearless when it came to guns. To that dog, a paintball gun was just a ball delivery system, and he enjoyed nothing more than to be fired upon at point blank range. He would be both the most fearless and the shortest lived warrior on any real life battlefield. A retro tourist boat, a replica of a Romanov era ship, appeared, floating into the inlet from the Gulf. The tourists on the boat peered at us. You could sense from the body language that they were concerned by what must have appeared a sizable army of men with machine guns. Cannon meat, someone shouted. Everyone who had already been massacred snatched up their markers and rushed to the shoreline. The tourists on the boat hit the deck. A downpour of paintball pellets rained into the water, just short of the boat's hull. So, you know, after that, I have this little section where I go to Moscow and I do one of like a dozen interviews I did with these actual Chechen vets who are writers who are writing about Chechnya. But I think I'll just stop with paintball and switch over to this thing. So my workshop requested a smorgasbord, so I'm gonna try and do right by them. Just gonna read a couple. These pieces are really small. But basically, you know, coolest thing about publishing a book is that sometimes someone actually reads it. I swear to God. I got an email, like 2011, 2012, from this British photographer. Said, hey man, I've been traveling around, I logged 22,000 miles traveling around the US. I've been taking pictures of empty motel rooms. I read your story collection. I was wondering if you'd like to write stories to go with them. And I remember so clearly, I just responded yes. I didn't Google the guy, anything. I just loved the idea so much. I've since got to know him, and we've done a couple things together. What was really cool about his pictures is he shot them with large format cameras with 45-minute exposures, so they're really like dense and lush. They're really beautiful. I wish I could have projected some up here tonight, but I didn't have the files. This little press called Mount Analog in Seattle printed them up in this book with my stories and his photos. I know you can't really see them, but the cool thing that they did is they printed the book like hardcover with gold embossing so that it looks just like a Gideon Bible, which I appreciate. But basically, what I tried to do is, at first I thought, you know, collaborations raise all kinds of interesting questions if you ever worked on one. But at first I thought I'd write some stories about some characters who inhabited those rooms. But then I realized that like narrative's really powerful and it would kind of change the photos in ways that I maybe didn't want to because they were so weird and beautiful on their own. Oh, he always mussed up the bed and had a TV on. So there was always the suggestion of a character in the room. Something else that I really liked about him. So what I tried to do is I tried to kind of mimic what his photos did. I tried to write a little piece that suggested a character and kind of suggested a story in that room, and then just kind of left it at that, you know? So I'll just read you a couple of them. They're really short, like one page each. This one's a Bluebird Motel. How do I pronounce this again, Jess? M-A-C-H-I-A-S? Machias, Maine. Bluebird Motel, Machias, Maine. This is fiction, by the way, right? A vandal has added the disturbed to my do not disturb sign in black Sharpie, if I read my marker right. This is a sentiment I can abide, but the disturbed people of Machias, Maine cannot abide the sentiment. Do not disturb the disturbed, I shout when someone knocks. Can't you read? It's the police, a female voice says. I peek through the curtain. It is a female police. Is there some kind of problem, officer? I ask. We've had some reports about a peeping Tom. Her eyes sweep the room behind me. I'm a photographer, I say. Can I see some of your photographs? She asks. I know my rights, but anything might happen in Machias, Maine. Luckily, I keep some pedestrian shots, framing the good ones on the front and back end. I toggle through about 5 images, several highway structures of Machias, Maine, a dilapidated old house, the do not disturb the disturbed sign. I guess you're not a pervert or a terrorist, she says. She pauses to register any slight telling reaction. So that one I actually wrote after talking to him for a while, because it turned out that he had, he wasn't only taking photos of motel rooms, but he had taken a photo, I guess, of a young girl like standing in front of a gas station in this little town, and someone had called the cops on him, and someone had came by, so I decided to, you know, play with fiction and non, I guess. This is Super 8, Elko, Nevada. I like my home. I like the sun, that's why I look like an alligator. Believe it or not, my ass is just as white as yours is. Had to spend the weekend in jail for DUI on my bike. Only had 2 beers. I never have more than 2 beers. They're supposed to charge you $1 a day to stay in the jail, which, that's a fair rate. Better than this shithole, AKA my home. Ended up with disorderly conduct. Stray socks, sweatshirt, duct tape, gas can, bucket, denim nauticas, heavy duty degreaser. I'm probably the only person that's got 0 on their credit system. Got out of the system. I'm out of all the systems except the police stations. That's the only one you can't get out of. I stopped paying taxes in 1989. I used to work out on the beams. I was the only one who'd work out on the beams. You get used to it. It's a whole new feeling in your toes. You drag a toe behind you. You can't think about it. Got to just not think about it. I used to work for a millionaire. Made $600 a week. Had a ski boat in the ski magazine, 3-car garage full of tools. He bought my beer and everything. But he got in trouble with the IRS and had to move to Canada. Poor guy owned a building in downtown Detroit. It's buggy even in March, holes in the screens, but it's home, just trying to make it nicer. I got to pick up my other bike at the police station. It's my motorized too. I got an old Coke bottle in the front basket marked Boston. It's probably 25 years old. Got an old tin milk can, going to make a still. Whiskey, you bet. TV cable makes the perfect clothesline. I got a whole roll of it. Must be 300 feet long. I've actually had my hands photographed for a prey thing. So yeah, I wish you could see this one, but you know, it's basically like a bed and like poltergeist TV and a mirror, a little green bucket back there. And sometimes in some of the shortest ones, I just tried to kind of play with the image and like focus on one detail and just kind of maybe shift the gaze or the idea about the image. This is just Motel, Nevada. How many times, green bucket, have they puked in you? That's it. Thank you very much.
I know that green bucket well. So I usually, when I'm sitting during the last reading, just sort of reflecting on everything that's happened, and usually some sort of super nerdy, obscure literary reference comes into mind. I think one time I just dug up some Proust for no reason. I apologize for that. But I'm not going to do that this time because, you know, just being under the weather for so many days and kind of watching our program from a distance in a way that I haven't really done before, I was just really taken by how lucky we are to spend these 9 days together on this campus, where one of the most audible, enthusiastic expressions of appreciation was not when Coulson was reading from Underground Railroad, or not when Jennifer Egan said she was done reading from Goon Squad, but when Jeff Parker said they have draft beer at KFC in Subway. Like, I've never heard people gasp that loud. So that's just one of the reasons why I love you guys. And over this last term, especially the way that we came together to support our program assistants and interns and faculty mentors just means the world to me. So I want to thank you guys and every member of the community who supports this reading series and this program for being here with us this January. So thank you to you. And one more thing. Keep your fingers crossed that there's no bomb cyclone in June, because Tracy K. Smith is coming back.